end of publishing and books are dead and boring. No longer can it be said that we like to read. My friends and I, we don't like the way books feel in our hands. It's not true that I don't follow trends. I know what I want when I see it, and packaging is more important than content. I have to tell you, my attention span is too small for big ideas. And it's just not true that I read a lot and I like learning. I don't care. And you should never think I've got to be concerned with environment and sustainability. What I really hope you get is you've got to open your eyes to my values. What's important to me is what Lady Gaga is wearing. And I don't really care all that much what Gandhi did last century. I think it's unbelievable that you're actually listening to us. What's important for you is you'll find customers for your products. You think your job's done if we like your brand. We'll do it for you on Facebook, on our mobiles, me and my friends. Your market is dying. Don't think it's all going to survive. It is the end of the publishing industry as we know it. Unless you reverse how you see me. It is going to survive. Don't think that it's all dying. Your market is me and my friends. On our mobiles, on Facebook, we'll do it for you. If we like your brand, your job's done. You'll think of products for your customers. You'll find what's important for you is that you're actually listening to us. I think it's unbelievable what Gandhi did last century. And I don't really care all that much what Lady Gaga is wearing. What's important to me is you've got to open your eyes to my values. What I really hope you get is I've got to be concerned with environment and sustainability. And you should never think I don't care. I read a lot and I like learning. And it's just not true that my attention span is too small for big ideas. I have to tell you, content is more important than packaging. I know what I want when I see it, and I don't follow trends. It's not true that we don't like the way books feel in our hands. My friends and I, we like to read. No longer can it be said that books are dead and boring, and this is the end of publishing.
I love this time of year because this is a time of year where everything feels new and fresh and exciting, and everybody's point of view is important and interesting, and you have a little bit of time before the mad rush of life overtakes us all to really stop and think and listen. We created this video in one of our divisions last year to really try and challenge ourselves to consider both points of view. That yes, the publishing industry might be dying and it might be dead and it might be boring, or it might be thriving and it might be incredibly successful and vibrant and important to huge numbers of people. And actually, of course, the truth is always that there are two points of view and neither one is right and neither one is wrong. And it's a bit like the great visual of the right and the left. You can waste a lot of time and energy trying to find the answer. And I suppose one of the things that I been doing over the last week, and indeed if you read all of our media and all of the blogs and all of the RSS feeds, everybody seems very excited at the start of every year to do top 10 predictions. And in particularly in the technology space, everybody's very excited to do top 10 technology predictions. And I have had an amusing time reading lots of these, and unfortunately, I have to claim the Financial Times has also done these, part of the Pearson Group. And indeed, lots of people who work for me like to send round their blogs and Twitter feeds and say, these are my top 10 predictions for this year. I thought about sort of just getting them all and taking the ones that I liked and making a list out of them and turning it into a PowerPoint presentation. And then I thought that was a bit of a cheat, really, and given that there's a lot of teachers and educators in the room, I would be found out instantly, plagiarism and all that. So what I thought I would do instead is actually share with you my New Year's resolutions, because I actually think what you're actually going to do is sometimes more important than what you're actually going to think. So here's my top six resolutions for the year, and it won't surprise you given the introduction that the first one is be disruptive. It's very easy to sit there and defend the status quo, but it can be a bit time consuming, and overall at the end of the day it's a little bit energy draining. So what I actually like to do is think about how I'm going to destroy Pearson. I think that's a much more useful and valuable thing for me to do for Pearson, and I encourage everybody who works for me to do the same thing. And I encourage all of you to sit there and think, what could I do to destroy Pearson? We very much rely on our technology partners, teachers, students, educators, to point out to us what we could be doing better. And if you can think of a way to destroy us, come and tell me, because I'd like to do it first. The sort of one of the big things that's happened, and I don't like to spend a lot too much time talking about e-books because it is a 20-year-old technology, so it's not exactly bleeding edge. But one of the interesting things that's happened in the last couple of years is the sort of perfect storm of device, content, and route to market. And this is just one example. I don't want to stand up here and be an Apple advocate, but given the iPad in the conference, it seemed only fair that I would think about this. But in terms of education, I think this is a really important disruptive moment, because we have a device that students want. We have a route to market that they understand, happy to access, is a part and seamless part of their life. It doesn't smell like school. It's something they do every day. And it's also a really good way for anybody to get content. So the interesting thing about the ecosystem now is what this enables you to do is you can have your teacher notes up there. The student can post their essay there. I can put my e-books up there from Pearson. We can have gaming apps. We can have an absolute huge variety of content that would enable a student or a teacher to learn better, to teach better. So I think this is a really important disruptive moment for us. What's important that we don't do is just try and use the channel or use the device or the operating system to replicate what went before. This is our moment, 2011, to really think about challenging what type of content we put up there, how we enable students' access to this content, and the business models that surround it. We have to really challenge ourselves in this space. I know some of you heard my colleague David speak earlier, and I don't want to go into games too much, but I think games are a really disruptive technology for teaching and learning, and very, very important to Pearson because of that. We know that kids engage with games. We know that some teachers and some educators consider games to be a distraction. What I find absolutely fascinating here, and I know David's given you some examples, and perhaps I've picked the wrong here with Greek mythology or Roman history, but 10 million kids have logged onto this game, and so 10 million kids have absorbed, albeit in an informal setting, an understanding of Greek mythology, of history, that otherwise they would not perhaps have been exposed to, but it was their choice to do it. It doesn't appear in the classroom, and they're not being given credit or awards or gold stars. It doesn't make it any less valuable, and in we come back to one of the earlier speakers, it's all about that kind of absorption of learning. It doesn't matter where it comes from. And I think games could be a very important part of that. Will we be able to deliver full curriculum in gaming platforms? Probably not. I don't think that's the point. I think the point is it's part of the learning experience and therefore has value. This is slightly showing my age, because this is from a very, very old film, and this is the HAL, the artificial intelligence computer. Luckily, some people are nodding in the room. Thank you for that. But I do think this is also, you know, a really interesting moment in time. We have a number of artificial intelligence capabilities in Pearson, nothing to do with me. But one of the interesting pilots that we're running this year is actually with a school in Singapore, where we're using artificial intelligence to mark English literature essays. No teacher marking. This probably won't be popular. No teacher marking, but we're using the artificial intelligence to automatically mark online the students' essays. And the reason we're doing it is we all believe in editing, we all believe in versioning, we all believe in formative assessment. If you're a teacher and being asked to mark an English literature paper 5-6 times before final submission, and you've got hundreds of students, that's really tough. So what do you say? You work on it on your own, I'll cast my eye over it in class. Or do you say, here's a piece of technology that will enable the student to get albeit automated, but feedback during the editing process and then teacher engagement. It's not about removing the teacher from the equation. It's hopefully about understanding if we can use AI to make the teacher's life better and to give better, faster, more frequent feedback to the students. Very interesting. Obviously, we do this in mathematics and science and kind of pure sciences all the time. Very interesting to be thinking about if we can use it in the arts and humanities. This is the slowest clicker in the world, I'm sorry. The second one is be global. Well, you know, I could stand here and I could sound as if I sort of work for some charitable foundation or I'm kind of, you know, paying lip service to this, but I really think this is a very important moment in time, not just because China is the second largest economy in the world or India is the fastest growing market in the world, because actually we have to challenge ourselves here. We can be very Western, we can be very Eurocentric, and in some instances, dare I say, we can be a little bit imperialistic in that we like to export our ways of teaching and learning to other markets. My challenge in 2011 is to make sure that we import teaching and learning capabilities and skills and technology from other markets into what we would call our developed markets. So the world is very important to us. Brazil is an incredibly interesting environment right now. Some of you will have heard of the Sistemas, which is a school in a box, which if you want to have a handy catchphrase for it. We now own 30 schools in Brazil where we run schools and we do everything from creating the learning systems, putting in the technology, running the buildings, making sure the lawns are mowed, making sure the kids are safe, employing the teachers, training the teachers, and running the high-stakes examinations at the end of the year as well. It's a very interesting model because that particular market, most kids leave school at 14, if not before. Only primary education is sort of mandated. So actually, that kind of system of school is a way to actually start pushing kids through to staying into high school and then into tertiary education. There are many, many markets in the world where governments are trying to experiment with the idea of free schools, schools which stand alone, schools which have autonomy. I think there are very interesting markets in the world, and Brazil could be one of them, where we could learn how to do that and run that efficiently. India, obviously an absolutely fascinating market in terms of education. Sheer numbers alone cause us to need to look at India and capture learnings from India. Also the rural, you know, difference between rural and urban learning. The interesting business that we have there is that we run a tutoring business from India, which is an on the telephone, Skype, and online business, tutoring children in mathematics and science largely. All of the kids who are being tutored are in the UK, Australia, or the United States of America. It's £10 a month, which if you look at what an average tutor might cost somewhere in southwest London, for instance, as I have experienced myself with maths tutoring, you're lucky if you walk away with £70 an hour as your output as a parent. So a very interesting model that we're running out of India. The China we talked about, one of our previous speakers talked about, it's quite interesting. This is, we're being disruptive in China and we're also trying to think about what we're learning in China could be exported. We are a teacher of English language in China. We have 70 schools in China where we teach Chinese children English, both written skills, speaking skills. We don't really do test prep. That's not what we're for. So we're not really for high stakes examination. We're helping people learn English so that they can be more creative, operate in the sort of in the 21st century world in China. It's been a real challenge for us. We took over the schools with a very different way of learning, and we're learning how to teach English in a different way to students and their parents who expect rote learning, drill and practice, drill and practice, and we're actually having to sort of challenge that ourselves. And then very quickly, I just want to talk about an investment we made in Africa. We are by no means the leader in this project, and I would hate anybody to think we are. There is a fantastic organization called the Bridge Schools, which operates in Kenya. This is a very interesting learning, I think, for us, because We often think that the only way forward in education is high stakes, high value, expensive, technology, digital. What the bridge schools do is take over land in shanty towns and slums and agree with the community that they're going to build a school there and pay the community money for the land. They set up a very, very simple corrugated iron hut and then they run a school in it at a cost of $4 a month, which is about 2 days' pay for the family. And the kids come, they're taught every day, the teacher turns up every day, they're taught a curriculum, they take national examinations, but it's very, very simple, mandated, basic education, but it's not a traditional model that a big company would come and put in. We would normally go and build something expensive that looks like a nice Western middle-class school. And what we've done here is actually work with the Bridge Foundation to listen to what the community needs, can afford, and is prepared to accept in the communities. It's absolutely fascinating. Our ambition with them is to open a school a day in the next 2 years, and that will simply scratch the surface of the educational need in that particular part of the world. But again, this is a model which could be used in rural economies all over the world. One of the interesting things here is I said, you know, I can't believe you don't have electricity in the schools. Why would you not have electricity? And the guy who runs it says, I haven't found a need for it yet. I'll let you know. So we have to challenge our perceptions. I know I don't have to give you a heads up on this one. Personalised learning, get personal. Very important to us this year. If you really want to see flowers bloom and deal with the multiple personalities and people that we all connect with every single day, then we have to find our ways of using digital technology to enable personalised learning. I could talk for an hour about the use that mobile devices, and I see all of you with your iPads, hopefully getting used to that and enjoying that. It's totally changed my life, mainly because I travel sort of 90% of the year and I don't have to take a laptop anywhere anymore. And also I conveniently leave my phone at home all the time now, so nobody can speak to me. But this is a very interesting experiment we've been doing with the state of Virginia, where we're taking a whole social studies curriculum to a classroom entirely on the iPad. That's the way you get your content, that's the way you take your tests, that's the way the teacher interacts with you, and it's going to be an absolutely fascinating experiment for us this year to see if we can actually demonstrate efficacy. Does this enable students to actually learn more efficiently? My math lab, I hope many of you know, this is our sort of complete blend of formative assessment, content and test taking, and connects up with learning management systems, school information systems. I sort of feel like sometimes I do nothing but talk about my math lab. We have 9 million students taking my math lab courses last year. It's an incredibly powerful tool for us. Our challenge is to take it internationally, to scale it beyond that. But I can't underestimate the efficacy testing that we do, the feedback that we get from students, being allowed to take maths in the privacy of your own home and with nobody watching you and all of your feedback happening online in private with nobody saying you're terrible at maths. It's unbelievably powerful. And then Results Plus, I mean, I guess lots of you know this. This is an EdExcel platform that we launched a couple of years ago. I personally adore this. I'm a parent. My kids took EdExcel exams. I suppose I fall into the nice middle class category now, although not always true. But this, I think, is a really powerful tool. Why shouldn't students know what questions they got wrong in their exams? Why shouldn't teachers be able to see what they were able to teach, what concepts and learning they failed to get across, where their school is weak, where their class is weak, where an individual is weak? Why shouldn't parents be able to see how they should be supporting their child, or, dare I say it, supporting their school? So I think this is a really powerful tool. We'll continue to build as much personalization and data export into our products as we possibly can. be valuable. I'm going to be very quick around this, but this is the key. We are a company. It is important to us that we are able to generate revenue so that we can go forward, so we continue to make investments, and so that we're able to still be here 100 years from now. Pearson used to dig tunnels and build bridges and run oil companies. I don't know why we gave up the last one. But, you know, if we want Pearson to be here 100 years from now, we have to develop sustainable business models, and they can be very different from the ones that we have today. But it's important to us to do that. We're trying to unlock the value of e-books. Of course, everybody can go on Wikipedia and download information. What we're trying to do is create digital products that enable people to engage with content, engage with concepts, and actually learn better than just downloading free content. I'll talk very quickly about geolocation, simply because 10 years ago, everybody said that travel publishing was dead. The travel publishing is a really important part of the publishing sector, which has sold more travel guides last year than it ever sold before, printed books. And in the digital space, everybody said nobody would pay. And interestingly, we launched the DK Eyewitness travel apps last month. They're the top-rated apps in the iBook store and in the book app store. They cost £10. Everybody said we were crazy. Nobody said anybody would pay for it. Guess what? It's great content. It's interactive. You can upload your own photographs, write your own travel reviews. People are happy to do it. And the Financial Times, I guess, is the poster child of paywalls. And I didn't want to let this opportunity pass by saying, you know, the Financial Times started charging for online content 12 years ago. Everybody said they were crazy and we would never exist and they wouldn't, you know, the newspaper industry was dying. What the tablet device has enabled the newspaper industry to do is really take that rich experience and browsability of the newspaper and make it work on a tablet device. It's interesting across Pearson, we work very closely with the Financial Times on understanding how they did this. Be trusted. I mean, I think that's one of the reasons why I sort of come to conferences like this. There are lots of companies who are no longer trusted, and the reason for that is quite often they forgot why they were there. And I just wanted to reassure everybody here that Pearson understands why it's here. We understand what our purpose is, and our purpose is to enable teaching and learning. We don't really do it. You do that. What we're trying to do is give everybody the tools that they need to do that better, to reach more people and to educate many, many more people in the world than we've ever been able to do before. The reason I put this up is not to sort of be mean about other companies, but really to say that in the digital space, of course, you can do anything. All you need to do is hire brilliant software engineers and fantastic content creators and spend a lot of money. But you have to ask yourself the question every time, why am I doing it? What is the purpose of this app or this online platform? And am I actually adding value in this space? So be trusted would be my other New Year's resolution. I have one more, which is eat less cheese, which I suppose we all have to think about at this time of year. And slightly eat less cheese, because I think that's all I did at Christmas for 2 weeks was eat cheese and drink red wine, and it has to stop at some point. But also because sometimes I can be accused of only singing one digital tune. And I do think in our education space, in our book publishing space, and in our news media space, a healthy, balanced diet is good for everybody. Thank you very much.